Thank you, girls. Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to worship as we gather together as two congregations. On behalf of the Bethel congregation, we welcome you from First CRC to our sanctuary. We welcome Dr. Jason Lief to our pulpit tonight. And we look forward to the time celebrating the ministry that we share with our girls and celebrating deeper than that, the grace that we've received from our Savior Jesus Christ who brings us together tonight. As we do that, just a thing to look forward to at the end of the service, we're going to invite you to stay and to fellowship as two congregations, and we're going to have cookies and punch, and so we want to invite you to stay and to just enjoy this time as two congregations celebrating our unity in Christ. And because of that, for Bethel members, our Care and Concern Group prayer times will be delayed 15 minutes tonight, so you have some time just to enjoy fellowship before you go off to prayer. With those announcements, as we begin the service, I invite us now to just quiet our hearts and to begin the service praying together. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we're so thankful for the beauty of this day. For the beauty even outside the doors of this church of trees that are waking up. The beauty of this first green gold. The beauty of the sun and the warmth. The beauty of springtime. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the creator. And that you have not only made this beautiful world, but you have made each of the girls here. We thank you that you have formed them, that you have fashioned them, that you have called them. And as we witness your work tonight, as they lead us in song and in readings, and as we reflect on your faithfulness to them and through them, we pray that you would encourage both of our congregations. Together we would lift your name high, that we would together would hear your word and be challenged by it. Together we'd be commissioned to leave this place for the building of your kingdom in this week. Father, we thank you again for your gifts through Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Friends, would you please stand for our call to worship? On this Gem Sunday, our call to worship comes to us from Psalm 99. The Lord reigns. Let the nations tremble. He sits enthroned between the cherubim. Let the earth quake. Great is the Lord in Zion. He is exalted over all the nations. Let them praise your great and awesome name, for he is holy. Reflecting on our God and his character, the psalmist calls all the nations to reflect that God is holy. Let's do that with him tonight, singing together, "You are holy." We're going to do this as a round, so those on the left side of church, south side, will start, and then on the north side, we will echo. Prince of Peace, who gathers us in this place, is the God who greets us with these words. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of you, now and forevermore. Amen. Friends, as God's people gathered here, would you please turn and give a warm greeting to all around you, especially from the different congregations. Friends, you may be seated as we hear now an evening psalm reading.
God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He is a strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall, but those who hope in the name of the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles, they will run and not grow weary, they will walk and not be afraid.
Friends, let's sing these words from Isaiah that we've just heard in the song, Behold Our God.
Behold our God, see this. litany now, and so I'll invite the gems to start making their way up here. But this year is a special year. It is our 60th year of gems, and we also have 60 girls in our gems group this year between First and Bethel and a couple other different churches that have joined us. And today we also like to invite all previous gems or Calvinettes ladies to also join us up in the front for our litany today. So you can start making your way up here now too. Jesus invites us to follow him, young and old, boys and girls. All peoples and nations are invited to receive his love and to live like him.
Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. 1 John 2, verse 6.
To walk in his steps, we look to Jesus and learn from him. We remember his love, words, and ways.
Jesus is our Savior, who rescues and forgives. He is Emmanuel, who walks with us and guides us. He is our teacher, who shows us how life works best.
Jesus acted justly, loved mercy, and walked humbly with God.
To walk in his steps, we look to Jesus and listen to him. We remember who he says we really are.
Therefore, anyone who is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here.
Jesus says we are accepted, loved, and have a place to belong. He says we matter to him. To walk in his steps, we will remember who Jesus is, remember who Jesus says we are, and then step in and love and live like him.
Jesus
different generations gathered together, and I'm sure John Calvin, to see that many Calvinettes would have just warmed his heart strangely. As those generations go down, we'd like to invite the younger generation up for a children's sermon led by the Jim. So if you're a boy or girl from whatever congregation, I invite you to come up now for a children's sermon.
How many of you can hear me? Very good. Today we're going to check how well you recognize sounds. So be very quiet so everyone can hear. Are you ready?
Okay. Everyone close your eyes. When you hear a sound, point to the direction it's coming from, but don't open your eyes until we say you can. Okay, you may open your eyes. What were some of the sounds that you heard? Go ahead, Asher.
A cow? How about you? Anyone else? You shout it out.
A harmonica?
Why were you able to recognize those sounds? That's right. You recognize them because it's not the first time you've heard them. The sounds are familiar to you.
This year in GEMS, we've been talking about following Jesus' words and ways, about listening to his voice and following in his steps. But we can't recognize the sound of his voice if we're not familiar with it.
So how do we do that? It begins with prayer. Spend time talking with God like you do with your own parents, and you'll get to know him better. Jesus knows you and loves you like no one else, and he is eager for you to know and love him too.
Thanks for coming up. Each of you can take a piece of candy as you go back to your parents.
Well, they're getting their candy. Hopefully they leave some for the rest of us. Our scripture passage this evening will be from 1 John chapter 2. We'll read 11 verses. Oh, there's plenty of candy left. First John chapter 2, starting at verse 1. Before I read, let's come to God in prayer. Father, we are so grateful once again today to be able to gather together as your people, to hear the word that you proclaim to us in your Son, Jesus Christ, a word of love, a word of grace. And now as we come to your written word, Father, we pray that the Holy Spirit would open our eyes, we might come to see what it means to walk as Jesus walks. All of this we do pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So 1 John chapter 2, starting at verse 1. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Now by this we may be sure that we know him, if we obey his commandments. Whoever says, I have come to know him, but does not obey his commandments, is a liar. And in such a person, the truth does not exist. But whoever obeys his word, truly in this person, the love of God has reached perfection. By this we may be sure that we are in him. Whoever says, I abide in him, ought to walk just as he walked. Beloved, I'm writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. Yet I am writing you a new commandment that is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Whoever says, I am in the light, while hating a brother or sister, is still in the darkness. Whoever loves a brother or sister lives in the light, and in such a person there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates another believer is in the darkness, walks in the darkness, and does not know the way to go, because the darkness has brought on blindness. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So for the Gems, you guys have been talking about walking, and a lot of the stuff that we have been doing here this evening is focused on walking step by step, this idea of walking in the footsteps of Jesus. And it's kind of important to remember that when Jesus was around and when his disciples followed him, when he was teaching his disciples, it wasn't kind of like we do today, right? If you guys are going to go learn, like tomorrow, where are you going to go? School. And what do you do in school? You read. Do you do it outside? Do you walk around with books and just kind of walk around? No. What do? You sit inside a classroom with all these artificial lights. But for Jesus and his disciples, you know what they did? You know how he taught them? What do you think they did? They walked. They would walk around. And they would see people and they would see things, and Jesus would tell stories about mustard seeds and about coins and about all the things that they would see. And so Jesus' disciples would follow him and they would walk and he would teach them. I want to tell you a little story about a time when I walked. I walked quite a long ways. Last May, I got to take a group of 6 students to a place called Italy. You guys heard of Italy before? All right. And we went to a place called Assisi, and we walked all the way from Assisi to a town called Rome. And we did that following in the footsteps of a man named St. Francis, or today we call him St. Francis. How many of you have ever heard of St. Francis of Assisi before? Anyone? Few of you. How about the rest of you? Who's heard of St. Francis of Assisi? A lot of times we know him as the statue guy, right? If you make a garden, you kind of stick a statue in there, and he's around the animals, and it's very peaceful and tranquil and all of that. But there's more to St. Francis than just being a statue in a garden where animals and things come. What was interesting about the life of St. Francis is that at one time, he was growing up just like us. And he had a mom and a dad, and his mom and dad had a business, and they did really well. And St. Francis was actually kind of rich. And he liked to kind of play and do all these different things, and he kind of lived the life, and he was kind of making his way up in the life of Assisi. And then one day there was a battle that broke out between 2 towns, and he really wanted to make a name for himself, so he decided to sign up and decided he was going to go fight this battle and he was going to go to war because he wanted to be a hero. He wanted to be able to come back, and in the eyes of all of the people in Assisi, he wanted to be a hero. So he went off to war, and he went off to fight, and guess what happened? He got captured, and he spent an entire year living in a dark cell, hearing his friends who had also been captured, not treated very nicely, and suffering. And so when they let him out, there was something about St. Francis that wasn't quite the same. There was something that had changed in St. Francis. And all of the different things that used to make sense to him, all the different way of life that used to make sense to him no longer made any sense. All the things that he used to care about, like money and partying and friends and all of these things, no longer made any sense. He even tried to join the army again and go back to war, but he just couldn't do it. And so what St. Francis began to do is he found this old church. St. Damian's was the name of the church. And he would go there every day, and he would sit, and he would pray. And he would stare up at the front, and you'll have to pretend just for a moment, but up in the front, there was what is called a crucifix. It was a picture of Jesus hanging on the cross. And as St. Francis was there, and as he was praying, he heard the cross speak to him. He thought he heard Jesus speak to him. And it said, "St. Francis, rebuild my church." And he kind of looked around and noticed that the church really didn't look very nice. It was kind of falling apart. So you know what he did? He went and he ran and he got a bunch of clothes that his dad would sell, because his dad would sell clothes. And he went and he sold them and he took the money and he brought them back. And he brought them back to the priest who was at the church, and he said, "Here, I want you to have this money to rebuild the church." And the priest got a little worried because he had no idea where this money came from. And so he said, "I can't take your money." So what do you think St. Francis did with the money? He threw it out the window. A big bag of money. The priest didn't want it, so he chucked it out the window, and he went back to praying. And he would pray, and he would pray, and he would pray. And he heard the voice again say, "Francis, rebuild my church." You know what he figured out? What he figured out, that it had nothing to do with the material stuff of the church. It had nothing to do with the building. It had everything to do with what it means to be a Christian and what it means to follow Jesus. And Francis looked around at his church, and he figured out that they were focused on the wrong things. They were worried about the wrong things. They were trying to fit into their society, and they weren't necessarily caring for the poor. And so Francis decided that he would try to live like Jesus did. There was a passage one time when Francis went to church that he was listening to the priest preach. And in that day, they spoke in a different language. Can you imagine coming to church and having to listen to Pastor Lee speak in French or speak in German? How many of you know French or German? Any of you? Well, one of you? Sweet. That's great. You're on the way, right? But imagine if you had to come and listen to Pastor Lee speak in French and you didn't know the language. And so there sat Francis, and he hears this. And after the sermon was over, he goes running up to the priests. And he asked the priests, were you talking about? What was it that you were preaching on? And so the priest helped him understand the passage. And guess which passage it was? It was Matthew 10, where Jesus calls his disciples, and he is going to send them out into the world. Now think about this. Jesus calls his disciples. What were many of his disciples before they started following Jesus? Fishermen. Tax collectors, they did a lot of different things. And Jesus comes along and he calls them out, and he's now going to send them out. And here are the words that Francis heard. It says this in Matthew 10. "The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You receive without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for laborers deserve their food." In other words, Francis heard this message and decided that what it meant to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, what it means to walk in the ways that Jesus walked, is to not be worried about things like money and all of the possessions and fitting into society. But to take the word seriously that Jesus gives his disciples, and to go out to the poor and to the sick. One of the interesting stories about St. Francis is that before he had his conversion experience, there was a group of people that were called lepers. How many of you have heard of lepers before? Okay? And leprosy was some kind of skin disease, and people didn't want to be around them. So if somebody was coming down the street, they would yell and they'd have to go to the other side of the street. And St. Francis despised the lepers. And in this town called Assisi, where St. Francis lived, there was a colony of lepers right on the outside of town. And one time, as St. Francis is coming along the way after he's heard Jesus speak to him, he's actually riding on a horse. And he sees a leper coming, and he's about to go by, and he decides, no, I can't do this. And he gets off the horse, and he walks over to the leper, puts his arms around the leper, and gives him a kiss. And then St. Francis turns around, and he's going to get back up on his horse. But what did he do? He looked back to see where the leper was. And what do you think he saw? Nobody. The leper was gone. You know what St. Francis thought right at that very minute? That this was no ordinary leper. This was Jesus. That Jesus had visited him in the leper, in the sick. And that if he hadn't gotten off of his horse and gone over and embraced this leper, he would not have experienced and encountered Jesus. So St. Francis got a whole group of people, and they would walk the countryside, and they would care for the poor, and they would care for the sick, and they would proclaim the gospel, and they would preach the gospel. And Francis led a renewal in the church, so that this to this day, we think highly of him, both Catholics and Protestants. We think of him as a great guy who brought renewal to the church. And why? Because he walked like Jesus walked. He did the things that Jesus did. Think about the things that Jesus did when he was out about walking on the earth. He healed the blind. He fed the poor or the hungry. He reached out to the poor and to the sick. He ate with the sinners and the tax collectors. In other words, Jesus wasn't concerned with his own well-being. He went to those on the fringes and those on the outside and showed his love to those people. And this is what St. Francis did. And this is how St. Francis walked in the footsteps of Jesus. Now, in our text here today, we're reading from a letter called John. John chapter 2 we read. And John is worried about people walking in the way of Jesus. Because in his community, what had happened was you had certain people who weren't treating each other very well. And so John is really focused on what it means to be a Christian. And one of the primary things that he says is that to be a Christian is to love. And we saw that at the end of the text. He basically says that if you can't love your brother and sister, how can you say that you love God? How can you hate your brother and sister and say that you love God? And so here what John is saying is he is calling the Christian community at that time to walk in the way of Jesus. And what is the way of Jesus? At my church right now, we are going through the Gospel of John. And what we are hearing is that Jesus gives them a new commandment. He says, love one another in the same way that I have loved you. How did Jesus love us? Does anybody know? How did Jesus show his love for us? Yes. He died. He died for us. And what John is saying is, and Jesus tells us that we need to love other people in the same way that God has loved us. There's a story in Luke's gospel where this guy comes up to Jesus and says, which is the greatest commandment? Jesus says to the guy, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as myself. But then the guy follows up with another question. And the question is, who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor that I'm supposed to love? And Jesus tells a very well-known story. How many of you have heard the story of the Good Samaritan? Right? Who could tell me really quick what happens in the story of the Good Samaritan? Go for it. Absolutely. So a guy, some robbers come, they beat him up, they lay him there, and you get a priest who walks by. And it's interesting in the story, he walks by on the other side. Not only does he just not walk by him, but he's like St. Francis used to be, where he didn't want anything to do with the person. Get way to the other side. Right? A Levite comes by and does the exact same thing. And then along comes somebody who's an enemy. They're not friends, right? They're not supposed to hang out with one another. And what's interesting in the text is that Luke makes sure that we understand that this Samaritan person comes near, and shows his love to the person who had fallen and was hurting and suffering and lying along the road. And Jesus is telling this story in response to the question, who is our neighbor? You see, what John wants us to know in John's letter, is that God has come near in Jesus. God comes near to us. God shows God's love for us by dying on the cross, by suffering with us. And now what he's doing is he's asking each and every one of us to come near, to enter into the life and the suffering of other people. And look, when you read John's gospel, what you see is basically this idea. How do you know when someone is a Christian? For John, it is not about doctrines. It is not about whether we use guitars or organs or mouth harps. You guys know what a mouth harp is? You stick it in your mouth and you boing it. Yeah, those are pretty sweet. None of those things matter. What matters is whether or not we are willing to love our neighbor. Are we willing to enter into the lives of our neighbor? Are we willing to show the love that God has shown us in Jesus Christ? This is what it means to be a Christian. And this is what it means for us to walk in the way of Jesus. Now, really briefly, here's what I hope for you. My daughter is in GEMS. Do you guys know which person this is? There she is. Anybody know her name? What's her name? Savannah. You know what I said to Savannah before I came here? I said, Savannah, you want to do the sermon tonight? What do you think she said? Yes. She said yes, but I didn't let her. Right? You know what I really hope for you guys? I really, really hope that you all learn to walk in the way of Jesus. And what this means is I don't want any of you to ever be afraid. I don't want any of you to ever be anxious about what other people think about you, or about what the world thinks about you, or about whether or not you're getting good grades or not, or whether you're the best athlete or best musician or any of those things. What I hope for you is the same thing that happened to St. Francis. Because you know what happened to St. Francis? He was liberated from it all. He didn't worry what people thought. All he knew was that he was supposed to love God and that he was supposed to love his neighbor and the people around him. My earnest hope for you, my great big hope for every single one of you, is that you really truly learn that God loves you because you're you. And that God wants you to become the best you that you can become. And that God wants you to follow in the way of Jesus, which means he wants all of you to love. So tomorrow when you go to school and you see somebody who's hurting or lonely or sad, you come alongside them and you put your arm around them. And you just kind of pat them and say, you know what? It's all going to be okay. Right? When you hear that somebody has lost a relationship or something's gone bad, you come and you enter into their life and you come alongside them. Someone on the playground who doesn't have a friend to play with, I hope you'll walk over to them and say, I want to play with you. I hope that you will become like the disciples, like St. Francis, and that you will learn to truly walk in the footsteps of Jesus, that you will be free to be who God wants you to be. And that in that freedom, you will learn to love one another. Does that sound good? All right, let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for these young women. I thank you for who they're becoming. I thank you, Father, for the GEMS program. I thank you for the people that have entered into their lives. Father, may we all learn to walk in the footsteps of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we come to embrace and recognize the love that you have for us in his death and his resurrection. Father, may we learn to love one another in the same way that you have loved us. We pray for these young women, Father. We pray that you will give them the courage and strength that they need to go into whatever this week or this month or this summer may have in store for them. All of this we do pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to respond, we're going to stand, and we're going to sing In Christ Alone.
In Christ alone, my hope is found.
Christ, you may be seated. We now, as two congregations, come before God's face in prayer together. It's our custom in the evenings at Bethel to have prayer requests, items of praise that we can celebrate together, or items of pain that we want to bring before God and lament, or anything in between. I know it's a little awkward when you have a bigger group, but I want to give an opportunity. If there are any prayer requests from either church, including you girls, if there's any prayer requests tonight. And if not, it'll be a shorter prayer. Any prayer requests? Yeah. Your dad is in Washington, so we're going to pray that he recruits better volleyball players than Northwestern. No, just kidding. Okay, oh yeah. Yeah. Okay, a little boy named Isaac diagnosed with leukemia. I'm going to pray for Isaac and his family. Thank you. Anything else? If not, yeah. Can you read that down? Jenny DeBoer? Denny. Okay. Okay. Denny DeWitt. Continue to battle with cancer. Another, yeah. For Haiti and Sarah.
Syria.
Okay, Haiti and Syria. I'm just not hearing well. Adults, the kids are beating you. Haiti and Syria, very good. Yeah. What's tomorrow? Oh, a court case, yeah, for adoption. Oh. For whose case?
Elijah.
Okay, yeah, so. I'm going to pray one of our families going through a case with a child. I'm going to pray for that court date tomorrow for Elijah. Anything else? Yeah. Pray for the Sunday school teachers as you're finishing the school year. They're going to probably miss you guys. So I'm going to pray for Sunday school teachers. Thank you. Okay. Good. Anything else? If not, let's bow. Yeah, Neil. Yeah, I want to pray for our college students this week, time of exams, graduation, and the new steps for some. We want to pray for them. Good. Good. With that, let's bow our heads and pray together. Gracious God, as we gather before you in the stillness and the quietness of this place, we thank you for the reminder tonight that the gospel is in motion. We read in Scripture so often your command to be in motion as gospel people. That we are the people who are to do justice and to love mercy, but also to walk humbly with you, our God. That we are those, as we've heard tonight, who are to walk as Jesus walked. That we are those, as we were reminded of this morning, who are to run the race before us, surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. Holy Father, that your gospel is in motion. And even in the quiet of this place, as we bring you our prayers, both the ones that we speak out loud and the ones that we keep in our hearts, Lord, that you hear these prayers and you are a God who is in motion. A God who is at work in this world, a God whose kingdom is coming even tonight on earth as it is in heaven. So, Father, we lift up this request that you would be at work in Haiti and in Syria. Both this poorest country in the Western Hemisphere and this nation so torn by war that its residents have fled to other nations. Heavenly Father, we pray that in these places of pain and lament, that we, your body, would respond with generosity, with hope. We would respond walking beside the hurting, even as we heard St. Francis did, that we would not run away, but that we would run near. Heavenly Father, as the gospel is in motion, we thank you that you are a God who uses us to train a new generation. We thank you for the Sunday school teachers at first, and at Bethel, who are finishing a school year, we thank you for the students who have spent a year learning, walking together around your word. Lord, we pray now that as we enter a season of separation, that you would continue now the lessons that you have taught, that we would grow in them, that we would embrace them, that we would live them out. Heavenly Father, we pray this not just for our Sunday school kids, but also for our college age young adults. As they finish semesters, as they finish school years, as some will graduate and enter into new places of service in your kingdom, as others will go on internships and travel. Lord, we pray that you would bless each of these students. We thank you for the colleges of this community. We thank you for Northwestern, for Dort, We thank you for the high schools. We thank you for the elementary schools, public and private. Lord, we thank you that you have provided for this new generation to know you and to have men and women who you've called to shepherd and to guide. We pray that you'd bless each institution. Heavenly Father, we do lay before you also our personal needs. We lift up before you Chad Hansen as he travels. We pray for safety for him. We lift up little Isaac as he battles leukemia. We pray that you'd guard his life, that you would bless his treatments, that you'd give him and his family peace. Father, we pray this for so many in our congregations and in our community in this world who are battling against cancer. We pray that you'd bless researchers with new insight into your world to fight this disease. And Lord, we wait for the day when you will eradicate cancer and death and you will wipe away these tears that we cry. Heavenly Father, we do lift before you also Denny as he battles his cancer. Lord, we ask that you would continue to walk beside this man, that you continue to remind him even tonight that you are a God who is near the brokenhearted and that you are Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. Heavenly Father, we do also pray that you would guide the court systems of this world and our government. We pray especially for this case with Elijah, that your will would be done, that Dean and Tara would experience your hand over this process as they seek to be obedient to you, and ask that your love would flow through them and in their family. Heavenly Father, we also pray as a community who has experienced the brokenness in our area Christian school, that you would continue to guide that process, that you would help us as a community be a voice for the voiceless, to speak up for those who are hurting, to be a place of compassion and of healing. And Heavenly Father, may we do this together by your Spirit. Heavenly Father, we lift these requests before you and so many other ones tonight. We pray that you continue to guide each congregation. We pray especially for First CRC as they look for a pastor, that you would bring them to the person of your choosing. You'd already be shaping us as a community, this is a congregation, and even this individual, to serve you well together. And Heavenly Father, that we would experience your gift of unity as we walk this road with your gospel in motion in us and through us in this world. So as we leave this place now into your mission field, may you go with us, may you prepare this week of service, and may you gather us again next Sunday to celebrate your continued faithfulness. Father, we pray this in Jesus' name, and all of us say, amen. Amen. We bring our gifts and our offerings together now as two congregations. It is an offering for the GEMS ministry, this ministry that ministers to our girls, and as we do, we will hear the song, Oceans.
Feeds my faith.
finish the service, we will sing our profession of faith together tonight. That'll be the song, We Believe, as the music begins. I invite you to stand and to sing this as a profession of faith. Thank you, Gems, for leading us, and counselors for leading our girls' congregations. Can we praise God for these gems? After our closing blessing, our closing song is, we receive your blessings, and then we will take those blessings to fellowship with one another around cookies, and then outside to this world, a gospel in motion, walking as Jesus walked. And as you do that, go with his blessing. Brothers and sisters, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.